given this, let's start with neural networks, right? And neural networks, as I was saying, is this kind of important field in machine learning, which is getting more and more important these days. And today, if you look at any machine learning conference, right, any leading machine learning conference, I can easily say that at least 60 to 80% of the papers will be neural network based. Right? That doesn't mean that, you know, the non-neural network stuff is dying or something like that. At least I personally believe that, you know, you need basically all kinds of methods, and it's not, I think neural networks and non-neural network techniques have their pros and cons, and you really cannot say that neural networks are the only algorithm, right? I think that would be what some people believe, but I do not think that is the way we should approach machine learning, right? Had that been the case, we would not have actually studied 90% of this course, which is based on non-neural networks. And of course, the neural networks do build upon a lot of the kind of more fundamental classifiers and kind of regressors, right? Like least squares and logistic regression and perceptrons, etc. So neural networks do build upon all of these, but that's not the only reason for studying the other methods, right? So things like gradient boosted trees, random forests, basically ensemble methods with decision trees, right? These are also a very powerful class of models that is used a lot in industry. And in fact, there are some problems where, you know, it's much easier to tune and train the gradient boosted family of methods compared to neural networks, right? But of course, having said this, neural networks are getting increasingly important, and they are becoming increasingly important in domains where you don't want to handcraft features. So neural networks allow us to actually kind of automatically learn features from data. So things like images, right? Images are an extremely complex domain, right? And until around 2010-2011, most of the techniques in computer vision were actually kind of handcrafted features, right? So basically humans, basically researchers, right, would come up with more and more sophisticated and more complicated techniques to basically kind of describe basically images, right, in a way that computers can understand. So you had basically pre-deep learning, right, or pre-neural networks. Actually, I'll call it deep learning because neural networks have been there from before. So I'll call this pre-deep learning era, right? And essentially you had an image, right? And then basically there would be this black box algorithm, which would oftentimes be very different from problem to problem, right? So this would be a black box feature extractor, right? And any computer vision paper, or like for that matter, even speech recognition, right? So this is like vision, computer vision, this is speech recognition, or like NLP or text recognition, right? Any of these problems, you would have this kind of black box feature extractor, which would probably be around 80 to 90% of the paper, right? This would be the critical thing, right? And then after this, once you're able to extract the features in a right way, then the machine learning is simple, right? So then you use some kind of a SVM, or logistic regression, or, you know, blah, 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 right? Maybe a simple perceptron even, right? And finally, you do some classification or object detection or recognition or like speech recognition or, you know, kind of entity recognition in text, right? So whatever your problem is, you would have this kind of a pipeline, right? And now more and more, so like this is the image, this is some basically input data, right? This could be an image. This could be a speech signal. It could be a text sentence or something like that, right? And now in deep learning, what's happening is that you have your input, right? And this piece is kind of completely removed now, right? And this entire thing is combined together to have the entire deep neural network architecture, right? And now this is where maybe most of the paper focuses on. So most of the paper would focus on actually building the architecture, building the model, trying to understand how to optimize this, what are some problems with optimizing this, right? And then you classify. So this is now basically what is known as end-to-end learning. And this is what is enabled with neural networks. So just a basically a high level idea, right? So an example for this is handwritten digit recognition, right? So this is a relatively simple task actually, because your input image is in fact black and white. So something like a linear model would actually not perform really bad, right? So for example, a simple algorithmic technique. So in fact, something like a logistic regression, very likely, right? Would easily get somewhere around 90 to 95%. Right, a support vector machine would easily get 90 to 95%. So you have a simple algorithmic technique, you can solve this problem with 95% accuracy, right? Why? Because there's a very simple input. The input here comprises of like digits with like black and white kind of inputs, right? And like, as you can see, the 10 classes are probably fairly well separated from each other. They could be probably classified with like a one layer neural network, like basically a perceptron or logistic regression, right? So you don't need a very fancy, you just need a linear classifier and that should be fine. But still there is still a gap, right? You would still only get 95% accuracy. So what this means in kind of getting to our machine learning language that we have been talking about, right? You have a simple linear model. A linear model is underfitting over here, right? So if you look at this in terms of the bias variance scenario, right? We are having a high bias relatively because we know that, you know, digits are an easy task, right? So we would expect that we would get near 100% accuracy. But the best we can achieve, even on a training set, the best we can achieve is only 95%, right? So this means that this is actually going to be a challenge, right? And this is an inherent kind of capacity issue that we absolutely need to have more complicated models to be able to deal with this kind of bias, right? Now, imagine that you're looking at a scenario like a kind of computer vision task, as I said, right? Where you're trying to detect if this is a person or, you know, this is a dog, right? Sorry. So like basically a person or a dog or animal, right? Or a cat. These are much more complicated problems, right? And these problems, if you were to use a logistic regression, I would actually recommend you to try this. In fact, I'll probably have like a simple homework question where you can build a neural network from scratch. In fact, maybe like NIST and some kind of a digits data set, right? And you can actually try this out. You can actually train a linear model and you can see what accuracy you're getting with a linear model, right? And then you can also take a simple computer vision data set, just take the raw input images, right? And maybe train a simple logistic regression SVM, right? I'm pretty sure you would get actually a very low accuracy. So you know that suppose you have 10 classes, right? For example, there's a data set called, like MNIST has 10 classes, which is like 0 to 9, right? So this is a 10 class classification. Another problem which has 10 classes is basically called CIFAR-10. So this is a data set in computer vision, which is actually very, very commonly used data set today in deep learning, right? For deep learning models. You basically take CIFAR-10 and you try a simple logistic regression, right? You know that a random model would get roughly 10%, right? Why would it get 10%? Can someone tell me what would be accuracy of just a simple random model? Any idea? Yes, Nathan.
With regards to like a uniformly distributed set of numbers, is that what you're asking?
Yeah. So basically like the model is just basically just randomly predicts the label at random.
Well, I mean, since there are 10 classes and since there's a uniform amount of them, you'd expect after a while it would have a 10% chance of doing
exactly,
it.
Exactly, right? So you are choosing something at random, right? So the probability of actually hitting the correct class is going to be likely 10%, right? So the expected value, the expected accuracy you would get would be 10%. So this would be something you would get of a random classifier, right? So it turns out that if you probably, like, I have not done this, been a while since I looked at this, but like on CIFAR 10, for example, if you take like a simple logistic regression model, you would get probably an accuracy somewhere around 30% or 25 to 30%, right? So what this means is that, you know, it's not random, right? There is still some signal, but the bias is very high, right? And today, some of the state-of-the-art neural network or deep learning models get an accuracy of like 92 to 95% on the test data set, right? So it's not just the training accuracy. The test accuracy is around 92 to 95%. In fact, I think like some of the even more complicated models like the ResNet architecture, which is basically used a lot these days, this probably achieves somewhere to a 98 to 99% accuracy. Of course, the model is much deeper and much more complicated. But what this means is that there is this big gap between the very simple models we have been studying so far, right? And what can be achieved today with deep neural networks, right? So that's the reason why it's kind of very legitimately so, right? And kind of rightly so, that we need to use these more complicated models. So today we will be basically just doing a very quick, kind of very basic study of neural networks. And I think, I mean, at some point I'd like to take actually a more advanced course on neural networks, maybe at some other point, or I think there are some courses offered at UTD on deep learning. So I would definitely encourage you to take that course if you're interested. Also, you can hear some lectures online by, you know, Jeff Hinton, Yann LeCun, and, you know, folks like that who are kind of experts today in deep learning, right? All right. So basically in 95% is what you can do on the simple task of like digits, like MNIST, right? And you can actually get 99 or in fact 99.5% accuracy with like a more complicated deep model, right? In fact, not even a very complicated model, just a model with like even like 4 to 5 hidden layers, right? And we'll see exactly what a hidden layer means, but basically 4 to 5 layers in between. With that, you can get around 95%, 99.5% accuracy, which is very close to 100%, right? Okay, so neural networks actually came up much before the kind of era of deep learning, right? And in fact, it came up in the 1940s to 1960s. And really the whole reason why it's called neural networks is because like a lot of this came up from, you know, folks in kind of cognitive modeling side, right, who are actually studying the human brain. So basically all kind of lot of cognitive researchers, a lot of brain researchers came up with this thing in basically conjunction with, of course, kind of mathematicians and machine learning researchers, right? But the whole idea is that they kind of were thinking that, you know, kind of a human, right, they were trying to imitate the way a human brain works, right? Of course, they had like some models and some data based on how humans function and how the kind of neurons of humans fire, right? And with that, they were wanting, and kind of a natural question is that, can even machines be made to learn basically observations and learn to classify or regress, or, you know, kind of basically take actions, or, you know, rank things, et cetera, right? So you basically want to be able to take all of these actions in a model which is very similar to the way the brain behaves, right? So that's the idea. So neural networks are actually biologically inspired, right? And the model itself comes up from a biological thing, but the learning is actually different, right? So it's not that we as humans learn in the way that basically a neural network will, right? So for example, we may not necessarily do an SGD algorithm. So the algorithms that have been developed for them so far are not necessarily biological, right? They are kind of more coming from the optimization literature, and they still work well enough. Of course, that means that there's probably a gap, right? One could argue that way as well. But at least the models are kind of inspired today biologically, right? And actually this is interestingly, this is kind of interesting because with this, right, once there was the sufficient computational power to actually learn the models, then they started performing very close to what humans can do. On I mean, albeit very simple tasks, right? Like classification, regression, not necessarily comparable to humans at like reasoning tasks, right? But at more more simple tasks like recognizing speech, recognizing objects, recognizing things in images, you were able to achieve something what a human can do using these kind of models. So the question then is that why did it take so long, right? Why is it the case that we kind of developed this in the 1940s, right? And in the 1980s and 1990s, in fact, Jeff Hinton and Yann LeCun and, you know, basically all of these guys who are today doing a lot of neural network, Yoshio Bengio, right? He's another guy. So like, all of these people were around in the 1980s even and 1990s. And in fact, they were publishing papers on neural networks even like 40 years back. But still, those techniques that time were like nowhere close to what things like SVMs were achieving, right? So in the 2000s, there was this kind of boost in a lot of SVM-based work. In fact, 80% of the papers in the 2000s were actually all SVMs. And there were very few neural network papers, right? And neural networks were kind of very fancy and nice. Backpropagation, in fact, was known. We'll actually look at backpropagation. It was known in the 1990s by actually kind of Jeff Hinton, I think, had the first paper on it. But still, it didn't come to fruition, right? You still couldn't actually get similar performance to SVMs and kernel machines. So the reason for this is because we didn't know how to train a kind of deep enough neural network efficiently, right? So the power was really from a systems level. The problem was really from a systems level, not really from a modeling or a optimization or a mathematical level, right? It was really from a systems level that just wasn't the compute required to train this like 20, 30 years back. And we didn't have the kind of powerful GPUs we have today that enabled this. So I think that's something very important to keep in mind. Okay, so neural networks are basically kind of building blocks that comprise of kind of individual neurons. And in fact, many of the simple neuron models we have studied in the past, right? So for example, the perceptron, right? So the perceptron can be seen as essentially one very simple neural network where we have basically your features, these are your input features, right? And this is your model, this is your perceptron. Right, so a perceptron takes in your input features, it basically multiplies a weight to them, and then takes a decision whether W transpose X plus B is greater than zero or W transpose X plus B is less than zero, right? And based on that, it will make a decision to classify things. So perceptron is one such building block. Another is a sigmoid. So sigmoid is basically like logistic regression or like multi-class logistic regression that we saw. Another kind of model is called basically rectified linear or ReLUs, right? So this is called a ReLU, rectified linear. And a lot of these models are what are known as essentially non-linearities. So non-linearities, right? So in some sense, like at a very high level, you can think of a neural network as kind of cascaded models where you basically recursively have models one after the other in a layered manner. And they comprise of essentially a bunch of linear layers. So you have a bunch of W transpose X plus B and a bunch of non-linearities in between, right? And a neural network is a directed graph. So it comprises of a bunch of nodes called neurons. And you have edges which are directed. The reason why it's directed is because you have an angle, you basically have a direction, right? So it goes from an input to an output. So that is the direction. And each edge is associated with a weight, right? Okay. So let's take a closer look at perceptron, right? So perceptron is this kind of very simple, basically individual neuron, right? Which is a node, and it just comprises of one node, right? So essentially you take in an input, which is here in this case is three-dimensional x1, x2, x3, and you do W transpose X plus B, right? So this is W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W3 X3, this is greater than a threshold, right? So if it's greater than a threshold, then it's one, otherwise it's zero, right? And oftentimes this threshold also is zero actually. So like actually another way to do this, or it's not necessarily zero, But another way to do this is to actually write this out as W transpose X plus B greater than zero, right? So you have like a bias term B, right? And this, you can basically take the threshold on the other side and then make this as a bias. Right? So bias is negative of the threshold, and then you just have this zero, right? So basically B is also a learnable parameter now, which you can learn. Okay, any questions so far? Yes, Nathan.
So we saw in the previous slide, it says that it takes a collection of binary inputs, but in the way that we've saw it, we weren't concerned about whether or not X, X1, X2, X3 was binary. Mm-hmm. So I suppose how does this definition translate into the version that we saw in the beginning of the semester?
Yeah. So that's a good point. I think originally this kind of comes a lot from historical precedents. So I mean, originally, right, you were thinking of models for like Boolean functions, right? And Boolean functions are functions where the inputs are binary and the outputs are binary, right? And in that case, like, people were trying to understand things like, you know, can a perceptron model, you know, different Boolean functions? So can it model, for example, a not gate, or can it model a XOR or an AND or an OR, right? And actually, we'll kind of look at some of this in the next few slides. So that's where the binary comes in. There is no need, actually, I mean, today, right? Today, a lot of the perceptrons are not requiring these, like, X to be binary. So this in fact works even if X is not binary. Does it make sense? So basically, binary is just there over here. It's not a definition that perceptron is tied with binary. In fact, when we studied perceptron, it was not necessary that X is binary, right? Even the weights are not necessary binary. But the output is binary. So Y here would be binary. So Y is 0 or 1. So perceptron is for binary classification. But the inputs are not necessary binary. Yeah, good point. Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, awesome. Yeah, so perceptron is usually expressed as a collection of input weights and a bias. So this is basically W, B, and these are like learnable, right? So this is what you would actually learn in the learning step, right? And a single node is just a simple linear classifier, right? So the very simple model. Okay, so this is where we kind of come back again, right? And now imagine that X here is in fact a binary input. Then the question is, can you represent a different Boolean functions with perceptron, right? So it turns out that you can represent, for example, a not with a perceptron, right? And a simple way of doing this is you choose just a one-dimensional, basically, weight vector to be minus one, right? And use the threshold to be minus 0.5. So note that if basically so essentially, like, X here belongs to 0 or 1, right? Or in fact, I think in this case, X belongs to, that's right. So basically, X belongs to 0 or 1, right? So this condition can be thought of as X basically less than 0.5, right? And this condition can be thought of as X greater than 0.5. So essentially, what this is saying is that Y is 1, if X is less than 0.5, right? Which means that if X is 0, then Y is 1. And if X is 1, then Y is 0, right? So this is exactly a not gate, right? For a binary input. Yeah, does it make sense? Any questions? So what this means basically is that we can easily kind of learn this perceptron now to write this as minus X plus 0.5 greater than 0. As essentially being 1, right? So this is now W transpose X plus B. So W here is minus 1 and B is 0.5, right? So this would be the perceptron corresponding to a not gate. Well, what about OR, right? So you can also do this for OR. So with OR, it's actually even simpler. You just choose the weights to be 1, right? So you have X1 and X2. Again, these are like Boolean inputs. And then what you do basically is that you do Y is equal to 1 if X1 plus X2 is greater than 0, right? So if either X1 or X2 is 1, one of them is 1, then the Y is 1, otherwise it's 0, right? And what about AND? Well, AND is the same, right? Except that now the threshold becomes even larger. The threshold is 1.5. So you need both X1 and X2 to be 1 for Y to be 1, right? If either one of them is 0, then X1 plus X2 cannot be greater than 1, right? So in fact, then X1 and X2 will be less than 1.5, so it will be 0 then in this case. Any questions so far? Or is this clear? Okay, I think this is fairly straightforward. What about XOR, right? So this is again the limitation of XOR. So if you saw, if you recall, right, XOR is basically represents something like this. So it represents basically, so if you have like X1 and X2 over here, right, and this is like 0 and this is 1, so you have 4 points, right? So 0, 0, right? So 0, 0 is basically, sorry, let's maybe change the color. So 0, 0 is red, right? And 1, 1 is red. So basically 1, 1 and 0, 0 are both 0, right? And if this is 1, 0 or 0, 1, then it's 1, right? So this is an XOR. And we saw that this particular data set cannot be linearly separated with a single linear model, right? So what this means is that the perceptron cannot actually separate this data set comprising of Boolean inputs, right? So what this means is that we cannot just have a single perceptron, we probably need to have a multi-layer perceptron, right? So this is in fact what this multi-layer perceptron is. And you have a bunch of perceptrons, right? So you have like and basically this kind of comes very simply from like simple circuits, right? Or like kind of basic AND gates, NAND gates that we have studied all in like simple kind of introductory courses in computer science, or basically undergrad and like kind of high school, right? So essentially, you can kind of represent this XOR as an OR gate, right? And an AND gate, and then followed by a NOT gate, right? And finally, you have this AND gate, right? Of course, there can be other ways of representing. This is one such representation. And this is an example of a multi-layer perceptron, right? That we are using to represent this XOR. And each of the weights need to be chosen. In this case, I believe the weights are all one. That we are representing this. So for example, the perceptron has, you know, the appropriate, like if this is a OR, then this is like 1 and 1, and we have the bias as like, I believe minus 0.5. If it's an AND gate, then it's again 1 and 1, and you have like minus 1.5 as the bias, and so on and so forth, right? So you have all of these different models that you can represent these perceptrons, and then you basically put it this way. So it turns out that you can represent any circuit or actually any kind of Boolean function you can represent given enough layers of perceptrons, right? And this basically is a kind of a very powerful, this is one of the reasons why you have neural networks as a very powerful class of models, because they are kind of arbitrary function approximation, kind of approximators, right? So you can approximate any arbitrary function very, very well given enough layers of neural networks. So in fact, we have one kind of representation theorem, right, where we will basically show the representation power of these neural networks. Okay, so given a bunch of perceptrons together, we get neural networks, right? So it's not necessary that these are like AND or OR gates. You have each of these perceptrons or each of these neurons, right? So these are all neurons over here. And each neuron is associated with a weight vector and a bias, right? And you can build this multi-layer set of neurons or multi-layer neural network or multi-layer perceptron, right? And this is your end-to-end model, right? Okay. So, all right. So the question is that we can kind of represent these more complicated models, right? And in the case of perceptron, we saw that we can actually efficiently learn perceptron using gradient descent, right? So we can come up with a loss function, which is the perceptron loss, And then given a perceptron loss, we can actually optimize this perceptron loss and then learn the parameters, right? So the question is that if we have a more complicated model like this, given the inputs and the outputs, so given my training data set comprising of a bunch of inputs and outputs, how do we learn these parameters, these internal parameters, right? So one simple way is that, well, why don't we just try to directly optimize like the Hamming loss, right? So the Hamming loss is also called the 0-1 loss. We basically saw this when we were looking at perceptrons, SVM, logistic regression, right? So we can directly optimize the Hamming loss or the 0-1 loss. And what's the problem? Well, the problem is that there are several non-linearities, right? In fact, the non-linearities are like basically truncations like this, right? So we have y being 1 if w transpose x plus b is greater than 0, right? Or 0 otherwise. So if all of these different layers, right, are going to have these kind of more complicated decision boundaries. So essentially each of these models, these kind of individual models, are going to be something like indicator of w transpose x plus b greater than 0, right? And these indicator functions are what make the end-to-end model very difficult to learn. So this is the problem, right? So small changes to the weights can cause kind of dramatic changes to the output. And there's this sharp discontinuities because of thresholding, right? And we also saw this in the perceptron kind of algorithm, right? So the question is that how can we relax this appropriately so that we can basically optimize this well? So this is where several non-linearities have been introduced, right? And the main idea of the non-linearities is that we can make this a little bit more continuous, right? And basically less discontinuous, and do this by basically introducing these functions, right? So one example of a non-linearity is a sigmoid. And we saw sigmoid when we were looking at logistic regression. And the sigmoid is essentially this kind of simple function, which is sigmoid of x. So in fact, I think I have the definition here. Yes, yeah, so sigmoid of z is 1 over 1 plus e raised to minus z, right? So essentially, the sigmoid looks something like this. So if this were to be a 0-1 decision boundary, then if it's less than 0, then so this is like w transpose x plus b, right? So imagine this is w transpose x plus b, and then w transpose x plus b is less than 0, then it's 0, right? Otherwise, it basically sharply goes to 1, right? So the red curve over here is the indicator of w transpose x plus b, right? And the blue one is a sigmoid of w transpose x plus b. Okay, so the sigmoid function is this continuous kind of approximation of this 0-1 loss and kind of makes it more smooth. Any questions until now? Or are things clear? Yes, Nathan.
So when we keep relating this to logistic regression, I remember going over like the logistic curve, mm-hmm. which would show like a probability. And then if we wanted to classify based into two classes, we could use whether or not the probability was above or below a half.
Yes.
And the result would give us a line, yes. which would be the discretized version. So here, I'm assuming that if we're wanting to produce an output that's between 0 and 1, which in this case is just a probability, we would be using the logistic curve and not necessarily the line that would separate distinctly into negative 1 or positive 1.
this is a good function. This is a good question, right? So kind of circling back to logistic regression, right? So logistic regression, we had the probability of, So we have the probability of y given x, right? And this probability, or actually maybe I'll just write it this way. So the probability of y equal to 1 given x was actually sigmoid of some linear function, right? So say W transpose X plus P, which was nothing but exactly 1 over 1 plus e raised to minus W transpose X plus B. So this is exactly the same as the logistic regression probability. In fact, the sigmoid function is nothing but what is used as a probability, and the output of the sigmoid, if you see, is actually between 0 and 1, right? So the input can take any value, but the output, you basically turn it into a value between 0 and 1, right? And in fact, you exactly see this with the sigmoid. You see that the intersection between positive and negative exactly happens at a 0.5, right? So the probability of y equal to 1 given x is greater than 0.5. This is exactly equivalent to saying that W transpose x plus b is greater than 0, right? And vice versa. Does it make sense, Nathan? So the sigmoid function is exactly, so the sigmoid function is exactly the kind of logistic regression probability value, right? And we do optimize this using a logistic loss, so that's a different piece that kind of relates back to log likelihood and things like that, right? But you can also view kind of analogously the non-probabilistic interpretation of the sigmoid, right? And you can view it now as a relaxation of the 0-1 loss function, basically. Or this indicator, you can view this as a kind of relaxation of the indicator, basically. Any other questions? Okay, so another another non-linearity is what is known as a rectified linear. And a rectified linear is basically a linear, right, but it's rectified. So it's basically max of 0, x. And in fact, this can be basically approximated by this smooth continuous function, which is log of 1 plus e raised to minus x, right? And this, again, if you kind of look back at the 0, 1, right? So sorry, the 0, 1 looks something like this, right? So this is a 0, 1 function. And now this is the kind of blue or the green curve, or this approximation of the 0, 1. Though I must say that over here, it's a pretty bad approximation, right? Because here the linear keeps growing, whereas here we kind of truncate this to a 1, right? But nevertheless, this is another such such a non-linearity that is actually oftentimes used today. Okay, so rectified linear units are another non-linearity. Another one is softmax, right? So softmax is this basically e raised to z over the sum of e raised to z. This is particularly useful for multi-layer basically inputs and outputs, right? So this is useful, for example, where we want to map a vector of real numbers to a vector of probabilities, right? And this happens a lot in the last layer. So in the last layer, you basically have like multiple, you have multiple inputs, right? And then you want to basically map this, for example, to a probability, right? And this is oftentimes the kind of softmax final layer of a neural network. Another nice interpretation of the softmax is that it is basically very similar to, this is an approximation of like max of k zk, right? Or sorry, it's the following. So it is actually very close to the indicator that zj, right? is the indicator that j is equal to the argmax over k of zk, right? So basically it's 1. The value is 1 if the maximum value is actually j amongst the different z's for the given input z, right? If the maximum is j, then the corresponding softmax of j will be 1. The rest of it will be 0. And this is actually an approximation of this. So it's not equal to, but it's going to be close. So that's why it's called the softmax. Any questions? Okay, so now let us build all of these. kind of let us combine all of these pieces together, right? And what does it mean to have a multi-layer neural network? So you have your inputs, which is X, right? And then what you do is that you basically multiply this with a weight vector. So this set of weights is a W, okay? So W now is a matrix, okay? And X is an input vector, W is a matrix. And this layer, which we'll call say Z1, okay, is basically W multiplied by X. Okay, so Z is itself a vector. Okay, and then what we actually oftentimes have is that in between this, right? So this particular layer, right, over here, we will actually have the following. So we will have first this term, which is Z1 equal to W multiplied by X, right? And then we will actually have the output, let's call it output O1, equal to some non-linearity, okay? Maybe some function f of Wx, right? So this function, one example of a function is like sigmoid, right? Another example is a rectified linear. So you have this linear multiplication of x, so you get z1 equal to wx, right? Maybe this is like w1x, right? And this is o1 equal to f1 wx, right? And finally, after you have o1, then there is like one more layer. So say this is w1, then there is one more set of weights over here, which is like w2, right? And then we repeat this. Again, we have w2, then we have W2 into F1 of WX, and then finally we will have like some sigmoid in the end or some other function, right? So you can represent this end-to-end function. So like G of X, where X is the input, you can represent this as the following function. So you say you have this to be like F2, suppose you have this to be F2, right? So this is essentially F2 of W2 multiplied by F1 of W1x, okay? So again, this is just one example. I'm not kind of exactly initialized what F2 and F1 are and what and things like that, right? So we'll basically look at this more concretely, but this is how a function like this would be defined. And a lot of this is based on matrix multiplication. So W is a matrix. The function f takes in a vector and gives out a vector, right? So the vector function. And similarly, basically x also is a vector, right? Yeah. Yes, Nathan.
So these weights, are they associated with the directed edges, right?
Yes. The weights are associated with these edges, yes.
And with those weights, are those the same weights that were appearing in, say, the whenever we were drawing parallels between logistic regression and the sigmoid neurons? Were those weights the same ones that appeared?
Yes. So these are the same, except that there is one difference. So these weights now are actually taking. So you have like. This is the input X, right? So we just take a look at the first layer actually. And then now you had like this hidden layer, right? So the weights now were actually combining this, right? So the way to view this, and this is the entire weight matrix, right? So this is not a vector anymore, it's a weight matrix. The reason why it's a matrix is that suppose this is Z, right? So you represent this as a Z1, Z2 until say Zk. Right, and you represent this as x1 until say xd, suppose, right? Then and this is basically x, right? This entire thing is x. So then what you can do is that you can represent z1, right, as essentially you take the first row w1, you take the first row of W and you multiply it with X, right? Similarly, you write Z2 to be the second row of W and you multiply it with X, right? So actually, maybe to be clear, I will do the following. So I will call this as W sub 1 and W sub 2, right? So this is like W2. And this is W1 over here. Okay. So W1, W, basically W sub 1 represents the first row of W, W sub 2 represents the second row, and so on and so forth, right? So you have ZK as WK multiplied by X. Okay, so now what this means is that Z, right, which is this vector, which is Z1, Z2 until ZK, is nothing but W1, W2 until WK, right, multiplied by X. So the size of W, so W is basically a K cross B matrix, right? And X is a D cross 1 vector. And Z over here will be like K cross 1. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, that helps visualize it better. I'm just, so the Z vector now, mm-hmm. rather, each Z1, Z2 to ZK would function as the weighted input of the next whatever neuron that you're using.
Yeah. So like there is a non-linearity over here, right? So say that there is one more thing. We'll call this say A1, suppose, right? Then there is this transformation that basically retains the dimensionality, right? But it just transforms Z1 to A1, Z2 to A2, and ZK to AK, right? And this transformation, so A1, for example, if this was sigmoid, right? This would be sigmoid of W1X, right? Similarly, A2 would be a sigmoid of W2X, right? And if this is AK, this is a sigmoid of WKX, okay? And then finally, then you have another layer over here, which is like say W, this is say W1, right? Then say this is W2, right? And then so you multiply now W2 to this input, which is sigmoid of W1X, sigmoid of W2X until sigmoid of WKX, right? And then you will get like basically this layer, which is like say Z2, right? So say this is like Z1 and so on and so forth.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so I think with this, we'll also look at this more concretely when we look at some notation. Another thing about a hidden, a kind of multi-layer neural network is that there is no hidden connections, right? So there is no interlayer connection. So basically, given a layer, we do not have these connections between the different nodes in a layer. We just combine across consecutive layers. Okay, so that's the major thing about neural networks. So this is kind of one visualization, right? So you have this input layers, the inputs, then you kind of multiply this with the first weight vector W1, right? And then you get a hidden layer which has 15 neurons, and then you have your second weight vector over here. And this particular piece is called fully connected. And the reason why it's fully connected is that every input connects to every output over here. So this is like a fully, basically a dense matrix of size, the dimensionality of this cross the dimensionality of this. Does it make sense? So this is going to be a full, the size is going to be a dimensionality of this multiplied by the dimensionality of this, right? Suppose this is like K and this is D. Then this matrix is actually a K cross D matrix, right? So it's going to be a fully connected or a dense matrix, right? Same with W2. Okay, so now with digits classification, right? What would be the output? So the output layer would have 10 basically outputs, right? So the dimensionality of the output would be 10. Can someone tell me why it should be 10 and why not 4? Why 10 basically? Yes.
So my first observation is it four because you would need four bits to represent all the numbers between 0 and 10? Or what? Why is it asking instead of four?
Oh, I think it's just arbitrary. Well, I mean, you could think of four that way, but it's just arbitrary. Like, why 10 and why not any other number? Like, say 6 or 8 or 100.
Well,
like in the case of digits, why would it be 10?
Well, I mean, there are 10 digits, but to do it this way also kind of reminds me of like a one-hot encoding scheme for like in circuits, but I'm not sure like why it has to be 10 instead of 4. That I don't know.
Yeah, okay, so most commonly, right, the way neural networks are, and particularly like any multi-class classification, would have this model where you are having the output size as the number of labels, right? So in the case of digits, we have like 10 classes, right? So the output would also have like 10, would be of size 10. And since this is typically a probabilistic model, right, the reason why I'm saying it's a probabilistic model is because you are having something like a softmax or a sigmoid in the end. So you would actually get a probability output over your 10 classes, right? And take a case of like logistic regression, right? In the case of logistic regression, we looked at multi-class logistic regression very briefly. And the multi-class logistic regression also looked at the same thing where we actually had like kind of extended logistic regression with a softmax to deal with 10 classes, right? So in the case of digits, since we have 10 classes, we would have 10 outputs. Right, but imagine you have another data set, like say ImageNet, which has like 1,000 classes as the output, right? So then the output dimensionality would be 1,000 over there. Okay, so it's a very simple thing. Just wanted to point out that typically in the case of neural networks for classification, we would retain the dimensionality as the number of classes in the end. Okay, so we'll quickly look at the expressiveness of of Boolean functions. So every Boolean function can be represented by a network with a single hidden layer consisting of possibly exponentially many hidden units. So this was one result. I don't exactly know where this was shown, but maybe if I find out, I'll actually add this to the notes. With continuous functions, it turns out again, very similar result can be shown, that every bounded continuous function can be approximated up to an arbitrary small error, right? With one hidden layer, and any function can be approximated to arbitrary accuracy with two hidden layers. So you have different variants of results. I'm not getting into the main proof or even the main statement of the theorem, but it just suffices to show that there have been results that have shown that with enough number of hidden units and with kind of enough number of layers, you can approximate any function to an arbitrary degree, right? And obviously the result will say something like this, that you can approximate this to an error epsilon with like something which is like polynomial in like 1/ε, right? Or something like this. So the size of the network will be polynomial in 1/ε. So some kind of a result like this has been shown in for neural networks. Okay, so this is one particular result. This was shown relatively actually recently by Zhang et al. Where they showed that there exists a two-layer neural network with ReLU activations and 2n plus b weights that can represent any function on a sample of size n in d dimensions. Okay? So what this means is that any function can be represented with basically 2n plus d weight vectors, right? So that means that you have like enough number of parameters to approximate any such function. Of course, this could mean that you could easily overfit with neural networks, right? So you can get like zero training error. So what this means is that you could easily overfit. So the bias is low, but the variance could be high. So it turns out that actually the generalization performance becomes very hard to kind of show theoretically. So if you were to show something like a bias variance trade-off or a generalization bound for neural networks, those do exist for neural networks, but those are much harder to prove. And
the results are actually very, very unconvincing. So there is no good theoretical result that I know of that can provably say that, all right, neural networks are like, you know, have a very low bias, but they also somehow magically have a low weight. There is no such result that shows this theoretically, but it does turn out that there are actually results that show in practice that actually, even though you get very low training error, right, and ideally it should overfit, the test error also is good. So it somehow generalizes well, but it does so while having, you know, enough number of parameters. So for example, what people have shown, right, this is very interesting. So people have shown that you give a completely random data set and neural networks can completely memorize the random data set, right? What this means is that if neural networks can memorize the random data set, it should basically be overfitting, right? But even though it memorizes random data sets, when it's given real data, it is able to kind of learn patterns in a way that it can still get 100% accuracy, but it can still get non-trivial test accuracy, right? So the test accuracy is not very low. So it's not purely memorizing like what a nearest neighbor model or, you know, just a plain memorizing would do, right? Or an extremely complex decision tree. Another example of something that memorizes blindly is a very complicated decision tree, right? And the decision tree would also get a very low training error, right? But it would have a very high test error, likely, because it is not generalizing well. But if you contrast this with neural networks actually in practice do not show the same behavior. Okay, so I think we are actually almost out of time. I do want to go a little bit into some details of training neural networks. We'll probably have to do a bulk of this next time, in the next lecture. But I'll kind of start off with the main intuition, right? So, all right, so we have kind of looked at it at a very high level, but I think we'll get into a little bit more concrete details as to what's going on, right? So we want to basically look at the learning problem as follows. So we have a multi-layer neural network. Imagine that the final loss function that you care about is a squared loss. You could also basically replace this with something like a cross entropy. Cross entropy is basically nothing but logistics, something like logistic, but for multi-class, right? So cross entropy is like the multi-class logistic loss, right? Or this could also be logistic loss if you have binary classification. So this could be any loss. Think of this like any loss function, right? So you have basically some loss function, which is 1/2m multiplied by L(m), comma A of xm, comma w, comma b. Okay. So we denote A over here as the output of the neural network of the nth sample, right? And w and b are the weights and the biases. W and b typically, by the way, are like matrices over here, right? Or actually multiple matrices. Because we have a multi-layer neural network, we want to learn the weights of each of the layers of the neural network, right? So these are like basically multi-layer matrices for W and B. Sorry. Okay. So we can compute the derivative here of the loss function, right? So if you're given a loss function, say the loss function is a squared loss, and the derivative is very simple. It is y minus a multiplied by the gradient of the activation A divided by the gradient of W, right? And this is the gradient with respect to W. You can similarly compute the gradient with respect to B, right? Also recall that the gradients of a sigmoid, the derivative of a sigmoid of Z is nothing but sigmoid of Z multiplied by 1 minus sigmoid of Z, right? So this is a result we will be using actually to kind of come up with the gradient computation. So the question is that how can we compute the gradient of this loss? And is there a kind of a natural algorithm that can do this? And it turns out that there is a natural algorithm, and this algorithm is called backpropagation. So what is backpropagation, right? So we look at backpropagation actually shortly. How many of you, by the way, have heard of backpropagation? How many of you are familiar with Okay, so it looks like a few of you are. Okay, cool. But anyways, I think we will still look at back propagation a little bit more carefully in the next couple of slides. Yes, Nathan, did you have a question or you were just...
Well, with regards to the back propagation, I've heard it in passing, but I had no idea what it is. My question, however, was I didn't get a chance to look at what A was again. Could you explain what the function A was?
Oh, so the A right now, okay, so the A basically is just the output of the last layer, right? So essentially you have your complete neural network model, right? So you have your X, okay? And then you have like multiple layers of neural networks, right? Right, and finally you have the output. We are calling the output A. It's basically also called activation, and then we'll actually define a symbol to define A for every layer. So we can look at the output of every layer, and we'll define those notations soon. But right now, think of A to be basically the output of the function. So this can be thought of as a function, right? Think of it as H or anything. I'm just using A, right? So it's A of X. It takes X as the input. This entire parameters is w comma b, right? So this entire function can be taken as a function of a of x comma w comma b, right? And this gives some output. And now given this output, we want to basically have a loss function, which is this loss of between y and a. Does it make sense?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so for example, right, we were using also a notation for h. We were also using a notation of h as the output. Or f, sometimes you're using f. So basically, like when this was just a linear model, this function is just w transpose x plus b. So it's a very simple model, right? Now it's a more complicated model. So we have this more complicated function h. And we will have to see how to stepwise do the gradient computation and the learning with this, okay? So the other thing is that I will discuss a few other examples of L. Right now, L is just a square loss, but next time we will discuss a few other examples of L. Okay, so I think why don't we stop at this point, and next time we will focus on learning with L and go over some details over the actual algorithm. And actually what I'll do is I'll also upload the slides toward the maybe shortly, like after the lecture, so that we can actually review, go over the slides in preparation for next lecture. Okay, sounds good. Any questions? Any other questions?